When it comes to taxes, what you don't know will still hurt you badly. So today in On The Money, our expert will make taxes easy for all to understand. Something that should help professionals and business owners as the April 15 deadline for tax payments draw near. I'm Edric Mendoza and you're watching On The Money. Our guest today is Hardy Aquende, a tax professor at Aquinas University College of Law and CPA lawyer. Hi, Hardy.
Hello, Edric.
Thanks for being on the show.
My pleasure.
You know, I'm very excited to ask you all these questions that I'm sure are burning in many people's minds. So I'm going to go straight to the first question, right? Tell me a little bit about your story. So you were one of the prosecutors of the Run After Tax Evaders program, RATE, you know, of the BAR before you became a tax professor. So what is that like?
Well, actually, Edric, it was very interesting for me to be a special prosecutor because I came from Acre Law Office,
right,
where I was advising clients, private clients.
Right.
And then it was a sudden shift to be part of the government and suddenly running after the tax evaders.
Right.
It was actually very beneficial for me. I mean, it was my strength, mm-hmm, coming from the private sector,
right,
and going into government service because it made it. I had the view from the private side,
and
so it was easier for me to see the schemes that,
right,
these tax evaders.
Right, you could understand where they were coming from. Okay, so now since we're talking about schemes of people, tell me, you know, people will say that cheating in the Philippines when it comes to taxes is almost normal, at least traditionally, you know, like jaywalking. But this has been changing apparently because of the new administration. How can or what is your perspective on that? Where do you attribute the change?
Well, I think, Edric, a big part of it is because the Pinoy administration is very credible to talk about the Daang Matuwid.
Daang Matuwid, okay. Yep.
And of course, our very good commissioner, Kim Inares, is also credible to head the BIR to run after the tax, mm-hmm, evaders and to be persistent in enforcing the tax laws. So I guess a big part of it is because we have very good administrators right now in this country.
I like just good sentiment, good vibe. Do you think it also helps, as you mentioned, with enforcement, that penalties are stricter now? Enforcement is much more stringent. Is that a factor as well?
Well, Edric, the penalties has always been the same.
Mm-hmm.
Ever since we had the tax code.
Okay.
All of those that's already there,
right,
already.
It's so the enforcement.
It's the enforcement. A lot of things has changed with very good enforcement in place,
right,
in this administration.
For example, I mean, let's talk about what is the worst case for a bad guy now? Person who's evading taxes, how bad can it get if they mistake their income or?
Well, basically, if you're prosecuted and found guilty of tax evasion, you have the civil penalties, you have criminal fines, but the worst thing is the imprisonment, which is, if you look at the law, they use the conjunction and imprisonment.
Okay.
So the most common provisions of the National Internal Revenue Code that's being used by the BIR to prosecute tax evaders are Articles 254 and 255. In 254, this is the ones wherein they use schemes to evade taxes.
Right.
It can go as bad as 2 to 4 years imprisonment.
Okay.
And if you refer to Article 255 of the National Internal Revenue Code,
right,
the misdeclaration of income and expenses, that could be as low as 1 year to as high as 10 years.
Oh, looking back, I can't remember going through a tax course that was standard for our college.
Mm-hmm.
And you know, I think it's true for many schools. They don't really teach you how to handle it properly. So let's look at the basics of this now, if you will. Now, can you tell us basics of being able to pay taxes for professionals first, like a doctor, dentist, lawyers? How do they go about doing that?
Well,
self-employed, yeah.
The self-employed individuals, which includes the professionals, are actually one of the classifications of an individual taxpayer.
Excellent, okay.
And this is, I'm saying this because I'm differentiating it from purely compensation income earners,
mm-hmm,
wherein they are not allowed to have any deductions, so their taxes are just withheld by their employers.
Employers. Mm-hmm.
But when we talk about the professionals or the self-employed individuals, the law allows them to have deductions. So from their total income, there are a number of allowable deductions. The very basic ones are the ordinary and necessary expenses to
ordinary
the profession.
Necessary expenses.
Yeah.
Okay, I like that one. Right. Okay.
And after reducing that by the allowable expenses, mm-hmm. you now take into account the what they call the personal exemption. So every individual, whether you're married, you're single, or you have kids, mm-hmm. you're allowed a 50%, that's 50,000 personal exemption.
Maximum. Okay.
And if you have dependent children, you're allowed an additional personal exemption of 25,000 per dependent.
Up to a maximum of four. So about 150,000.
Yes.
Maximum.
So after taking mm-hmm. that into account, you come up with the taxable income mm-hmm. and using the graduated schedule mm-hmm. for tax rates for individuals, you now compute for the tax liability.
Right. And then this is filed and paid annually, right?
Yes, that's correct.
As a self-employed. Help expand a little bit on the ordinary and necessary deductions. What were the examples of those?
Well,
for
we say
self-employed. Let's look at a profession like, for example, a doctor.
Yes.
What would be an example?
So, an ordinary and necessary expenses for a doctor, say for instance, is if he or she has a clinic.
Okay.
Then it's an ordinary expense to have rental expense okay. for a clinic. It's also an ordinary and necessary expense to employ a secretary mm-hmm. to take care of the patients okay. and all the other incidental expenses which we can consider as necessary right. in the practice of his or her profession. Say, for instance, the electricity,
sure.
the utilities, that's part of it.
Okay, excellent. Now, all of those expenses you're saying can be classified as that, and therefore, would there be a maximum cap that the government allows? Like, okay, if 100% is what you're earning, mm-hmm. you can only have 80% maximum ordinary and necessary expenses.
Well,
deductions, rather.
Edric, the Philippine Tax Code doesn't provide for any cap.
Okay.
Although, of course, it would be...
So experience-wise, what would you say experience-wise a professional should think of as a guideline? Okay, you know what? Here's more or less a percentage that you can work with. Is there one like that? That seems reasonable in general?
Well, I think a guide could be the optional standard deduction, which is provided for by the law.
Okay.
Which is 40%.
I see.
This, we say it's optional standard deduction because instead of deducting your income by the allowable deductions, item per item.
With all the receipts.
And all that. You can, in lieu of that, you can use 40% deduction, no questions asked from the BIR, as an immediate deduction. So this 40% is actually what the Philippine legislators think
is reasonable. I see. That's a very good guideline. Okay. So now very clear for self-employed. Any other advice as far as the basics of filing and the composition for self-employed before we look at the employer, business owners?
Well, I guess the basic tip to avoid getting into trouble with the good commissioner.
Right.
It's just to declare all the correct amount of income mm-hmm. and reduce it by what is only allowed by the law.
Okay.
Then I guess if that's the framework that you're working with, you'll be fine.
Sure. Okay. Let's talk about business owners. For a business owner who will now be filing their taxes, what would be the basics that they have to consider? How do they go about that?
Well, Edric, business owners are actually classified together with the professionals. So it's basically the same.
I see.
It's basically the same.
Once a year.
Mm-hmm. Once a year, and then they're also allowed the deductions, the ordinary and
same, okay.
and necessary deductions,
right.
expenses. And aside from that, these business owners usually are able to have more deductions. Why? They have more deductions because as a business owner, there are more of other things that they can put in as ordinary and necessary expenses. But that's not the case all the time. Mm-hmm. So it's basically the same treatment as a professional, same way to compute.
But there's just more things that are technically covered by the ordinary and necessary. I see. Okay. And the timing also, it's once a year for business owners.
Yes, the timing is the same.
Right. That's great to know. We just have to pause for a short break. So stay tuned. On the Money, we'll be right back.
Welcome back to On The Money. Let's check what Salve Dublito has for us in Salve Says.
Is it possible to navigate tax waters on your own? Our email sender today asks, Dear Salve, I resigned last year to become a freelance artist because I had a baby, and now I have to file my own tax return. Is it possible to do this on my own? Sincerely, Moira. Dear Moira, don't despair. Most of the times, our fear gets the best of us. Let's look at the Bureau of Internal Revenue website to see just how friendly it is to those who want to do a DIY approach. Commissioner Kim Henares herself challenged us to do this in a previous episode. From the BIR homepage, you click on BIR Forms, and then you find a long list of forms that you can download. Since you're a freelancer now, being paid fees by different clients, you will need to look for a different form than the one you were using as a regular employee. You have several options here. There's a PDF, an interactive, and a package that contains a document with instructions and an Excel worksheet. The BIR informed us that the interactive format does not work so well in a Mac, so you have to use a personal computer. Now, I understand that this looks terrifying, but if you look at it closely, it's not that hard to fill up this form, and all the terminology that you need to understand is in the BIR website itself. Now, what's more difficult is making sure that you have the required attachments, like your Form 2307 or creditable withholding tax from your clients. Now, if you have a good system of recording your monthly cash flow, you will have no problem because the information will literally be at your fingertips. So, can you file taxes on your own? I'd say yes. Try this yourself. Fill up this form, file, and pay with an authorized agent bank. But do it today. You'll get crushed by the long lines come April 15. The earlier, the better.
Still with us is Hardy Aquende, a tax professor at Aquinas University College of Law and CPA lawyer. And of course, Melissa Aquile with your money questions. Hi, Mel.
Hi, Edric. Hello, Hardy.
Hello, Melissa.
Taxes.
I know, very timely.
Yeah.
So let's get started. Marianne has the first question and asks, if I'm a regular employee with earnings on the side, how do I file my tax?
Okay. So Marianne, you just need to use BIR form 1701, wherein you have to reflect the income that you earn from your employer and add to it the earnings that you have on the side. And then, as we have discussed earlier with Edric, you have to reduce it by the ordinary and necessary expenses, and then you get the taxable income. And you can use now the tax rates as provided for in the tax code.
Mm-hmm. Okay. Even the specific form, that's good.
1701, yeah.
Yes,
now,
I know.
The ordinary necessary expenses, do those all have to be supported by a receipt of some sort if you're going to use that option?
Yes. Okay. So you have to itemize it, and there has to be a substantiation requirement,
right,
which are the receipts.
Right. Okay.
Unless, of course, you want to use the optional standard deduction, as we have discussed earlier.
Sure.
Okay, I think Edric and I are going to start using the ordinary and necessary.
Already?
Yes.
Yes.
That's right. That's good to know.
Very good to know.
Okay, our next question comes from Dolores via email, who asks, how long should I keep tax records for? I'm a small business owner. I have a catering business in a public school here in Quezon City, and I've been paying taxes and want to make sure that if I am audited, I will have documents to show to the BIR.
Okay, Dolores, regularly the BIR would look into as far as 3 years on your records. But if the BIR finds out that there is, I'm not saying that you're a tax evader, but if there is fraud or any findings on the part of the BIR, they can go as far as 10 years.
Oh my goodness.
So the usual advice that I give my clients and personal friends is to just keep on saving your records as long as you have the space for it.
How can you, what if you don't have the space for it? Are soft copies okay? Can you scan them and
save them? Yes. We're in the information age, so.
Okay.
Soft copies.
So imagine you have to have 10 years worth of receipts. Right. Present how many boxes? A room full of boxes to the BIR.
But of course, if you don't have the space, then at least 3 years.
Okay.
You'll be safe.
Okay. And do they all have to be official receipts, or can they just be regular?
Well, if the BIR is auditing a particular taxpayer, they would definitely look for official receipts.
So keep every single receipt you get, just to play
Even digital
safe.
Archive is good, right? You know how they have those thermal receipts? Mm-hmm. Those don't last, so you don't want to keep those.
Well, you can keep those. What my clients would usually do is to photocopy them.
I see. So you have, something that will last.
Or scan it.
Yeah. Digital archive.
Yeah, mm-hmm. That's right.
Great advice.
Or you end up with a blank piece of paper to BIR.
Are you kidding me?
That's right. Okay, now Ronnie emailed us and says, what are the allowable tax deductions for professionals? I am not earning much as a wedding photographer since I am also still studying in a distance learning school, but I am the main breadwinner and head of the family.
Okay, so I would assume that Ronnie is a wedding photographer.
Mm-hmm. Yes.
So as a professional, we have discussed earlier that you are entitled to the ordinary and necessary expenses. So if you're a photographer, then maybe you have expenses for the depreciation of your camera equipment, the salaries that you pay for your staff, mm-hmm. and all the other things that you can think of that's necessary in being a wedding photographer. Mm-hmm. So that's it. And as you mentioned about being a head of the family, we've also mentioned earlier with Edric that as a head of a family, whether or not married or not, you're entitled to a 50,000 personal exemption as a deduction. And if you have kids, if you have dependent children, you're entitled to additional 25,000 per dependent, up to a maximum of 4 dependents.
Okay, can he also claim on whatever fee he's paying for the distance learning school?
Oh, that one I think is not connected.
Okay.
It's not necessary.
It's not ordinary.
Right, oh, okay.
It's not necessary.
It's not necessary.
So I would classify this as a personal expense.
Okay.
I mean, improving yourself and
okay.
Paying for studying.
But he could claim on transport. If he has a car, has to take transport, he could claim on that.
If he's going to sites to take photos and be with the wedding people, then...
Okay, good. But
what about trainings to help him become a better photographer?
Yes.
I mean, classes like that, if he
Courses.
Takes that, is that something that is technically classified as an ordinary and necessary expense or deductible?
Well, I would think it's not, because that's not part of the income. What the BIR is actually looking for is the matching of income and expense.
I see.
So for your earnings as a wedding photographer,
currently,
then you can only use.
I see. I will need my car to get the money to take the photos. I need the camera. I see. So it has to be directly correlated.
Yes.
So car, gas, maybe even clothing. If he has to attend weddings, he's got to have formal wear, I suppose.
Well, I guess if occasionally you have your camera that's stolen or it's lost, then you can also, that's as an additional deduction, you can declare that as a loss, and that's allowable because our tax system is fair, so they have provisions for these kinds of unfortunate events.
Okay, great. And is it gonna be, is it easy for somebody to do their own taxes?
Well, it depends how complicated your business is, how complicated your profession is, but theoretically, it's possible for every individual to file their own tax returns. Mm-hmm. The only thing you don't want to make is the mistakes that the BIR might use in order to audit you.
Sure.
And so to avoid that.
To avoid that, you should maybe
consult a
professional, but also take time to learn your own.
Okay. Good to know. Now, Felina emailed us and says, I'm a stay-at-home mom with a slowly growing cake business. My husband works in Makati in a bank, and I would like to simplify our filing of tax returns and file it together as a couple. I sort of read that this is possible. How do we go about this?
Okay. Is that possible?
Yes.
Yes, Edric. In fact, if you look at the tax code, if you're a married individual, you're actually required to file a joint tax return with your spouse.
Oh, okay.
Yes. So if you look at the BIR form 1701, it would have two columns. One is for the taxpayer, and the other column is for the spouse. Mm-hmm. So you basically just have to follow the same computations that we run through earlier. Mm-hmm. Your income, allowable deductions, same for your spouse, mm-hmm. allowable deductions. And then when you total them, you can now compute using the tax rate that's provided for in the mm-hmm. tax code.
Okay.
Now, this is a question of ignorance, but obviously my dependents and my spouse's dependents will not be treated separately. Mm-hmm. It's not 25, it's since we're combined already, that's just our combined yes. deduction. Okay.
So in this particular case, the proper thing to do is to declare the, or to take advantage of the personal exemptions coming from the dependents to Felina's husband, who is the one employed, mm-hmm. and then Felina would no longer have personal exemption insofar as a dependent.
Sure. Now, what if one is employed? They mm-hmm. still have to have a combined one? Because the employed would have his filed separately by the company.
Mm-hmm. Right.
So how does that work?
Well, this is, in fact, I think, Edric, the question of Felina.
Yeah, her there you go. Yeah, exactly.
Her husband is employed.
Mm-hmm.
And she has earnings on the side.
Separate.
So they can choose to have a combined tax returns. Or
she can do it alone.
Or she can do it alone if the ones that is being earned by her husband has already been taken care of by the employer.
Okay, now Tina asks, in the past years, I've not filed taxes and then decided to do so this year. Will my past records be dug up and will I be fined?
Well, truth. Sad to say.
Truth.
Yes, the BIR can run after you. Mm-hmm. And try to assess you with income that you haven't filed your returns. So you would necessarily be assessed for deficient taxes. And of course, since it has been in arrears, there are penalties. It is subject to the interest plus a surcharge of 25%
for
the delayed payment. But if the BIR finds out that you've done it maliciously, there is fraud, then the surcharge would be 50% instead of the 25% surcharge.
Is there no kind of tax amnesty if she tries to file for all those years that she didn't pay? Is it possible for her to go to the BIR and say, look, I didn't file my taxes before, mm-hmm. I've been remiss, I know, I'm really sorry, I want to file them now. Is there some way that they can give her some kind of amnesty or a payment scheme? Because she might not be able to pay all those back taxes from however many years it's been.
Well, sad to say there's none. But occasionally, the BIR would have, in occasional tax filing seasons, they would have what they call tax amnesties. Mm-hmm. But that doesn't happen every year. It has to be declared, right. Yes. So there has to be an active action from the BIR
right.
for them to do that.
Well, actually, I wanted to talk about this book of yours, the BIR Forms Guidebook. Mm-hmm. I think we could all use something like this. I know
it's
I'm
like
gonna
a 101, right?
Yeah.
When it comes to taxes. I mean, like I said earlier, in schools, I don't know if you had it, but in our school, they don't teach us the basics of how to handle it after work, when you start working. Well, so that's what that covers?
Actually, Edric, mm-hmm. when I wrote this book in 2011, what it actually inspired me was my experience in the BIR, in the local, the district offices. Mm-hmm. A lot of people seem to not to know what forms they need to file, what taxes they need to pay. So I thought of making it easy.
Mm-hmm. There you go. Yeah.
Great. Well, I'm going to have a look at this mm-hmm. so that I know how to file my forms correctly.
Yeah, I hope it helps.
I think it will. Anyway, send us your money questions via email, Facebook, or Twitter, and we'll try to answer them in our upcoming episodes or on our next Q&A Friday.
All right. That's our show today. I'm Edric Mendoza. Join us again tomorrow for more talking tips so you're always right on the money.